Hello there, welcome back to Beyond Ballistics. As promised, here's an in-depth steel blowing video, which is actually the first of a 3 video series. In its most loosely defined form, blowing is any process that makes steel change its color through the formation of iron oxide on its surface. Basically, we cause iron in steel to react with oxygen on the surface, and the oxide film that results is what is going to give color to our part. Depending on the specific process, this can yield an array of different colors. For example, getting a thick coat of black oxide will get, well, a black oxide finish.
We should refer to the process as blacking, but we tend to generically call it bluing anyway, even though there often is no blue at all in the color obtained. If instead we get a thick coat of ferric oxide, we'll get a reddish brown, common on older shotguns, for example.
In the gun industry, this process is normally referred to as browning. Finally, if we get the film of oxide to be thin and very uniform, we can access the much larger color palette of thin film interference colors.
The processes to obtain that oxide film can be divided into 3 main types: heat bluing, caustic bluing, and rust bluing. We'll start from this last, leaving the other 2 for as many videos.
As the name implies, in rust bluing the oxide layer is obtained through a controlled rusting of steel. After all, rust is mostly ferric oxide.
Now, before going any further, let's see what rust bluing can do, its pros and cons, and what jobs it is most suited for. With rust bluing you can get any shade of grey, down to a deep black, or you can get brown. In this video I'm focusing mostly on grey and black, but I'll also tell you how to get brown.
As for the pros, the main one is that it requires very little equipment. All you have to do is warp the surface with some chemicals, wait a certain amount of time, and then dunk the part in plain boiling water. So you don't need any harsh chemical bath to submerge the part in, nor reaching high temperatures. This means it won't damage solder joints, nor the temper and heat treated parts. Also, it means you can get away with boiling assemblies of multiple parts, since there is no chemical that might remain trapped in the crevices between each of them. As for the cons, first of all it's very labour intensive since multiple applications are usually required and each surface to blue has to be accessed manually. This also means that it's a rather slow process, even though the technique I'm sharing with you is quicker than traditional ones. You're still looking at many hours to get a finished bluing though.
Another thing you can't do with this technique is getting a shiny bluing. You see, bluing is only a few microns thick, so it will only be as smooth as the surface underneath it. To get a shiny bluing, you need the underlying surface to be shiny. However, even if you do, some surface roughness is inherent to rust bluing and will yield a very typical and usually pleasing look, commonly associated with early 1900s guns.
Just be aware that if what you're looking for is the shiny black of a modern Colt or Smith & Wesson revolver, rust bluing is not the way to go. Now let's get into it.
We need rusting to happen on our part, but we can't just let it rust in the rain. Firstly, because we don't want this to take forever, and secondly, because we want rusting to be uniform. Keep in mind that most ways of rusting metal will work to some extent, but only a few will do it satisfactorily. I will only show the way I've settled on after all my experimenting, because that's the best I can suggest, but be aware this is not the only way.
Most of traditional recipes either involved toxic mercury chloride or had a short shelf life, so I've done a lot of testing over the years to select formulas that were effective but didn't use toxic or unstable mixtures, and this is the best one I've tried so far. It is made up of 7.5 grams of zinc chloride, 5 of ammonium chloride, 2 milliliters of maximum concentration hydrochloric acid, and distilled water to reach 100 milliliters. This formula was originally developed by Engier. All the chemicals involved are quite easy to obtain, non-toxic and unregulated, so you should be able to buy them fairly easily. Just mix them in the proportions stated, or maybe get your chemist to do it, and you're done. It will store indefinitely in an airtight container.
However, I can already imagine somebody commenting that zinc chloride is not exactly a household ingredient, although easily available, so I'll give you a way of obtaining the same result starting only from household items, but keep in mind it's going to be a bit trickier and dangerous.
We'll need a new, unused zinc carbon battery, ammonia and muriatic acid. First of all, you need to gather the zinc metal from the battery. Not every battery is the same though, the label must not say alkaline. You are going for zinc carbon batteries, which are usually the cheapest and shortest lasting. Sometimes you'll find heavy duty written on them, other times there's just no reference to the composition whatsoever. Remember that the battery must be unused. Also, get the largest size cell you can find, it'll make things easier. Take apart the battery while doing your best not to short the positive and negative terminals, remove the carbon electrode and the black paste that's around it. What you're going for is just the casing, which is made essentially of pure zinc. Wash it and clean it as best as you can before cutting it into strips. This is going to be your zinc rollstock. Then add 20 milliliters of maximum concentration hydrochloric acid into a graduated cylinder, weigh out 3.6 grams of the zinc metal you gathered, and slowly add it to the acid one bit at a time, trying to prevent the solution from overheating. You'll see it fizzing profusely, evolving hydrogen gas. The last piece will take a few hours to dissolve, so cover the top, but do not seal it. You must allow hydrogen to escape. What we've done is forming zinc chloride in solution. Now we have to add ammonia to form ammonium chloride. Ammonia is sold as a water solution in many different concentrations. It's not important as long as it's listed on the bottle and over 2%. We want to add 1.6 grams equivalent of pure ammonia. You can find the milliliters needed in this table, depending on the concentration of your ammonia. Upon addition, you might see a white precipitate forming. That is normal and will dissolve upon stirring. At this point, simply top the solution to 100 milliliters with distilled water. Then bottle your solution in an airtight container and you're good to go. Now take your metal part and thoroughly degrease it using acetone, brake cleaner or any other fast drying degreaser, whatever is easier as long as the part is clean. From now on, you'll have to work with gloved hands or you'll leave fingerprints on the finish. Take a cotton ball, put some of the solution on it, but don't soak it. Swab all the surfaces you are willing to blue. The rusting solution is just a catalyst, so a small amount will do the trick. What is actually reacting with the metal is oxygen, which is our next ingredient. Traditionally, oxygen was provided by air, which means that you would simply let the part you've treated sit to rust in air over the course of a few hours, somewhere between 4 and 48, depending on temperature and humidity. You can definitely do that with the solution we've prepared, but there's a much quicker way if you want. In fact, oxygen can also be provided more readily in the form of hydrogen peroxide. Any concentration between 3 and 6% would work. The higher the concentration, the quicker the action. What you do is soak another cotton ball with it and start repeatedly going over your part. You'll immediately see it turning orange as a very fine-grained coat of rust starts developing, which is just what we want. Using hydrogen peroxide is not only much quicker, but also easier, especially for a beginner, since it gives you much more control over evenness. After a few minutes of swabbing, the surface will almost look like it's made of copper, and that's the time to stop. All we have to do now is rinse the part and then dunk it in boiling water, keeping it to a rolling boil for about 15 minutes. Over this period, some of the rust will chemically react and turn black. After then, simply take the parts out and scrub them with fine steel wool. Most of the black oxide will easily wipe off, except for a very thin, tightly adherent layer on top of the surface, which is our newly formed bluing. And that's your first pass done. All you have to do now is repeat the whole thing, except degreasing of course, a few other times, until you reach the colour you desire. Repeating the rusting, boiling and scratching will increase the thickness of the oxide layer until you reach that fine deep black that we all love. Depending on the starting point and the darkness you're going for, you may need anywhere between 2 and 8 passes, with 5 to 8 being required for deep black when starting from white metal.
In my experience, natural rusting requires a few less passes than peroxide rusting, but of course each pass takes hours instead of minutes.
Anyway, once you're satisfied, you can go to oiling. Keep in mind that without oil, a blued surface is only marginally more resistant to corrosion than the same unblued steel. However, bluing helps retain oil much better than naked steel, and that can indeed improve corrosion resistance as long as the surface is kept oiled. Practically any oil will do the trick. There are stories about certain oils damaging newly formed bluing, but I've honestly never seen this happen in person. Any gun oil I've tried worked fine for me, but do your own testing just in case. Even better is to use a thin coat of a drying oil, usually boiled linseed oil, but you need to make sure that you don't leave any excess or you'll end up with a sticky surface. If you watch some of my main videos, you've probably seen me using different rust bluing solutions from time to time, and I'm essentially doing it to try not being repetitive, but I've found no real advantage over the zinc-based solution, so I'd suggest you stick with that first before trying anything else. Before leaving you, I want to quickly address browning. It's still an iron oxide coating, but it contains a higher amount of ferric iron than black oxide, and you can obtain it by doing the same process I just described, but without the boiling in water step.
Basically, you just rust the part, scratch the surface with steel wool, and repeat. This takes more passes than blacking, and the result is less wear resistant. The colour you get is also more dependent on the specific rusting solution you use, and there are some actually designed for browning, which I'll cover in a separate video at some point. And that's basically it. Let me know how you get on with the process in the comments, and best of luck.
Once again, a huge thanks goes to my patrons, which as usual are all listed here. Thank you all for watching, subscribe if you'd like to see more, and I'll see you next time. Bye.